there for 20 hours.
So I'd like to thank you all for coming this morning. It's great to see so many community partners here in the room who have been supportive of this initiative that we have been working on for quite some time now. And I would like also to thank some folks in the room for their support. State Representative Claire Cronin, thank you. State Representative Michael Brady, thank you. And also we have some special guests in the room from Wiley USA who've been very supportive of O'Colony Y. Jeff Sutherland, back there getting coffee, thank you. And Carrie Johnson, as well as Vinnie Monterano, who is our CEO and president, and some folks from the State Alliance, Peter and Kate Marie, thank you so much for joining us today with all the other partners in the room. Due to all of the work from all of you in this room, the Wyatt of the USA has chosen us as one of six Y's nationwide to conduct the listening forums. So we thank Wyatt USA for this opportunity and joining six other Y's in this listening forum across the nation. The work we will do today is a first step towards creating a community partnership roadmap for improving access to health care. As I mentioned, this is a national dialogue that's happening right now around the nation, and we have learned from these forums that have happened elsewhere that there's a lot of pieces to accomplish this work are already in place in the community. It is a collaboration such as this that will help us map out and put it all together. We have also learned that the forums have run out of time before they get to the next step. So I want to make sure that we do keep it timely, and we do have a staff over here that will help us. I'll introduce you shortly to Alice, but we have Sue Spiller over there, and Leah Saffron, and Lauren Bettel, and Kendall Bennett. So they will all help us run the forum and keep it timely so that we have enough time to get as much input as we can. Before we start, though, I do want to be a web satellite. We are going to introduce Matt Longdon, who is a National Health Officer for Wiley USA.
Hello, I'm Matt Longdon, National Health Officer for YMCA of USA. Thank you so much for coming to today's event. The Y in your community has been selected as one of six Ys around the country to host these events. These listening tour events are designed to help share the stories of successful partnerships that have been emerging in your communities and a few others over the last decade. Our focus, with support from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, is to gather stories and best practices about how YMCAs and other community-based organizations have partnered with healthcare organizations and communities across the country to close, or at least narrow, what we're calling the clinic-to-community gap. Across the country, over the last several years, we've seen certain trends emerge, and we hope that the questions that you'll be working through today, the stories you'll tell, the history you'll share, will lead us to some best practices, some new resources that we'll be sharing with WISE and with other community-based organizations over the years to come. Generally speaking, we've seen at least five stories emerge out of the preparation for this work in today's event. In addition to all the great information that I think will be unique to your community that will come out of today's event, we want to make sure that some of these stories relate to the following five kind of examples of things that we're hearing about from around the country, in no particular order. The first story that we are hearing is that to close the community, the clinic to community gap, WISE and healthcare institutions have begun sharing physical spaces. They've built new buildings. They've brought dock-in-the-box operations into rental agreements inside YMCAs, or they've gone together to other locations like grocery stores and retail outlets to deliver evidence-based programs or other things in shared spaces. Another story that we're hearing, and we hope your experiences will back up in some way or another, are that these evidence-based programs that are increasingly being reimbursed or paid for by ACOs and healthcare systems that know that savings are on the back end are a part of the story of your organizations coming together. A third story is how WISE are helping individuals and families, maybe perhaps most importantly, new Americans, undocumented Americans, navigate a confusing system that can sometimes keep them from getting and taking advantage of clinical preventive services, screenings, vaccinations, that are so important for overall health. And another story is exactly what I know is happening in your community, the collaborations that have to happen to make these different experiences real and realized in your community. We know that the maps that we have, the lines on the map that maybe draw a distinction between one YMCA service area and another YMCA service area, don't often hold up when we are working across regional lines or across a whole state level of organization. And the last story that we want to make sure also might emerge is how this mechanically happens. What are the legal compliance discussions that are happening? What are the data systems requirements that are getting worked out? I hope you will think about these five stories as you progress today, as you go through your experiences and document the great history of your work in your community. And I sincerely thank you for contributing to what will be a national dialogue about how a community-based organization can have a broader voice and engagement in closing the clinic to community gap. Thank you very much.
So as Matt, Dr. Longdon has said, you know, I think we're all here to figure out how we can all work together in our communities to ultimately lower the cost of healthcare across the nation and what part we can take, as well as how do we get people to live a more satisfied and long life. So Alice Rabella, who is our REACH director, is going to introduce the forum for today, how we were going to collect this information, and then we will wrap up and we will be sharing this information with you. We have a Healthy Living newsletter, and if you signed in, you'll receive that newsletter, as well as through the CDC REACH, we'll be doing some reporting back as well. So Alice, do you want to take over?
So great to see a room full of people, and let's do what we do best, collaborate and share successes. So as we progress through the morning, you will be working with a group of facilitators, whom I'll introduce a little bit later on. And we're going to be talking about and asking questions relating to the state of health care in our region, and how do we forge these relationships and really close the gap between the clinical community and the community in general. So on your tables, you have some sticky notes. And those are for emerging questions. Should we not be able to get to you right away? I want to be sure that if you have this great idea or a great story that you want to share with us, we want to capture that. So feel free to jot those questions down on those sticky papers, and one of us will run over to you. So raise your hand, let us know that you have it, and we'll get it from you. And we just want to make sure that we capture those and we don't want to miss anything. So at the end of each question, you can hold up your sticky note or raise your hand and we'll go over to you and you can give us your answer. And as Joyce indicated, everything is being scribed. All the information will be communicated back to WISE the USA, which we're very thankful for today's session. When you do write your idea or your question on your sticky note, feel free to write your name on the back with a phone number. Should we ask for further clarification? This way we have a way to follow up with you. So right now we're going to show you another quick video on patient-centered care, just to get you thinking about the topics that we will be discussing today.
What is patient-centered healthcare, and why is it important? When it comes to healthcare in this country, we do something very well. We spend more, and we get less. Each year, we spend almost $3 trillion on healthcare, yet we have skyrocketing rates of chronic diseases. Our health and our healthcare system are in crisis. Part of the reason is that the sickest 5% of our population uses over 50% of our resources. That's just not sustainable, and something has to change. One solution that can help is patient-centered healthcare. Patient-centered care focuses on wellness, not on sickness. What would that look like? With our patient Malia, it means we do more than just see her when she wasn't feeling well. It means we encourage and even help her get more physically active. We recognize that good healthcare includes the body and the mind, integrated primary and behavioral health. Finally, our dietitian would teach Malia to prepare meals that could help control her diabetes. By also involving her family, we strengthen her support system and make it easier for her to stay well. Patient-centered care takes a team of doctors, nurses, and other providers, all working together with you and your family to keep you healthy. Patient-centered care accomplishes three major things. First, by being comprehensive and proactive, it improves your health and keeps you well. By keeping you well, it also controls healthcare costs. Finally, your experience as a patient is more satisfying and you live a longer, healthier life. Patient-centered care will transform our disease care system into one that focuses on health and has been shown to work all over the country, improving quality and saving hundreds of millions in healthcare costs. This kind of healthcare is being called by a lot of different names. As a patient, this can be confusing, but it shouldn't be. Because patient-centered care isn't a name or a checklist. It's a partnership between you and your healthcare team. As a patient, you have the most important role in improving and maintaining your health. And that's why community health centers are so vital. Because we believe in providing proactive, comprehensive, patient-centered care and focusing on quality innovation and in partnering with specialists, hospitals, and other organizations to improve your health. From providing essential care to communities in need to treating the whole person all in one place, community health centers are doing what's right for everyone.
So as you could see from the video, there are many components that contribute to good health. And I think it is time that we shift our focus from treatment to prevention. And as we all discussed this morning, what the gaps are and how can we go about closing those gaps, I do encourage you to think about your personal experiences, your experiences in your work environment, because this is the only way that we can really get to the root of the problem and really start to talk about what can be the solution. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Lauren Bartel, and she is the Director of Healthy Living for Old Colony YMCA. Thank you.
Hi everyone. Again, I'd like to thank everybody for coming. So to start it off, we're gonna do a little raffle here for some gift cards. So I'll shake this up a little bit. Let's see. All right. The first raffle goes to Beth Ann Higgins.
Yay.
All right, so okay, so everybody has little clickers on their table. I'll have you pick those up. We'll start with a question that we'll have you all answer. So you'll see the question on the screen. What percentage of emergency room visits are for non-emergencies in Massachusetts? So I'll have you pick what you think. You can press the letter that corresponds to your answer right on that clicker. Okay, so I don't think we're going up anymore, so I'll have Kendall show us the answer over here and what everybody else has chosen. So it looks like 50% of the people have chosen that 40 to 60% range and then kind of split on either side with higher and lower. And the correct answer is actually in that 40 to 60% range, 44%. So that is actually pretty high. So I'll pass the mic on now to Hillary to talk about the healthcare landscape and we'll discuss possible reasons for that high percentage.
So I first, before I ask this question, I just want to bring your attention to this paper that I just found on the tables. I think it's really important as we go on to some of these questions, in case some of you are not familiar with what some of those acronyms stand for. To what extent do accountable care organizations, or ACOs, or other risk-sharing models exist? for a quiet group this morning. And the video that we just watched, it actually addressed the patient-centered medical homes. So this next question is, to what extent is primary care being organized and delivered through patient-centered medical homes? Not much. Okay.
I'm a visiting dental hygienist, so I'll go into different sites like this, and a lot of places don't have any care coming into them. And some of the care that's coming in, these big conglomerates come in, and it's kind of sad because they really aren't, patients become more of a commodity. They're no longer a person, and it's how many can you get through? Both, you know, you have to, we've got to make so much because they're on MassHealth, and we have to, you know, the quotas have got to be in, and we're not going to make money, and the person gets totally lost, and the care is not what it should be. It's very frustrating. I don't know where the answer is.
Thank you. Looks like we have somebody up in the back here.
My name is Marilyn Gardner, and I would say in theory, it's supposed to be happening a lot across the nation. I think that the rub comes with what is happening in practicality. So we can talk about patient-centered medical home all we want. One of the questions we might even ask is, whoever asked the patient about that term medical home? I don't know about you, but when I go to the doctor's office, I'm not going home. It doesn't feel, you know, and so just even the terminology, I think we erred with the terminology, never having any focus groups saying to people, what do you think of this term? You know, does it remind you of a fireplace and, you know, curling up with your doctor? I'm sorry, that was so terrible. But I think there's a huge disconnect between those in the healthcare industry, and I'm one of them, and those outside the healthcare industry, just in terms of talk versus what's actually happening.
Thank you. You make a great point there.
And so we can say traditional. Can people kind of describe what you mean by traditional when you say that we're traditional instead of innovative? We had nobody say innovative.
Traditional would be going to your doctor's office, and innovative would be having services come to you and service you how and where you want to be serviced. If you're sending all these people to the emergency room, they have to go through policies and procedures, when indeed it might be something totally different that they want to be cared for. So if they're being cared for in their home, you're saving a lot of money, not running a bunch of tests.
When I think of traditional, I think of someone that's coming to the doctor after they already have a disease, it's already happened. Whereas in innovation, especially I think across the world right now, there's becoming a much more, they're putting more of an emphasis on prevention work, which I think that innovation is hugely in prevention in general.
So. So do you feel like you're seeing that innovation right now, or it's starting to come?
I think I see it more in other countries than I do here.
Okay.
I do, and then you go.
Good morning. What comes to mind when you talk about innovative is getting, from a clinical perspective, is getting patients to not just come into the PCP's offices, the specialist's offices, when there's something wrong. It's just getting members to come in and get back to using the insurance that they do have. So it's just coming up with ideas to collaborate together with patients and members and with the community to remind everybody that healthcare, you know, should be a top priority.
Mm-hmm. So using it before you get sick.
Right.
To prevent.
Thank you.
So I think an innovative method that has begun at Brockton Neighborhood Health Center and my doctor's office is the patient portal. So it really supports what you were just saying, that healthcare is not just when you're sick. Healthcare is for reminding people, you know, what it takes to stay healthy and of all the new initiatives that are going on.
I'm coming from South Coast Health, and innovation for us is something really new, and we feel very fantastic, is that, you know, we find out that patients come into the ED and they're using it as their primary care because they don't have physicians. And the problem is that, you know, people with chronic disease, is they can't manage their chronic disease because they don't have food, they don't even have places to live. So until you solve that problem, find solutions for that, they can't even manage their chronic diseases. So we've been helping them with the community health workers and trying to like bridge, going out to them, having them be the eyes into the community and bring back information to the providers so that they can help better understand their patients. And so for us, that's innovative.
It sounds like when we are saying about the traditional, especially when someone just spoke about the patient-centered medical home, I noticed a couple times many, many patients have been diagnosed with a hypertension without having hypertension only because they feel nervous when they go to doctor's appointment. So usually what we do to make those people to feel like at home is we need to make them to feel welcome. And for the innovation, like we have now, as I was thinking, because the hardest part is to make those people like a little change in the culture that is hard to make with a chronic disease self-management program that is like now handed by community health workers. So we have been educating patients in order for them to feel welcome when they are going to the doctor appointment, even if they are sick or not sick, at least to feel welcome when they are going to the doctor's appointment.
Anybody else that would like to comment on that initial question?
Right in the Elder Services, we're actually training leaders out in the community, so we're being innovative by training leaders to be leaders of chronic disease and other evidence-based programs.
Yes, I know everybody in the room is young here, at least most of us. In our parents' generation, or some of the people in the room's grandparents' generation, the doctors used to go visit the patients in their homes. And I know the visiting nurses do that to take care of patients that can't get out of their home. And I've gone on visit tours with some of the VNA employees to see how they take care of people in their homes. But we've evolved from those days. And then, we all lead busy lives. We're rushing to get to the doctor's appointments on time, and sometimes they're overbooked, and you're waiting there on hours on end. And it's a system, and the cost has gone through the roof. We've got to do a better job educating the public, because a lot of the public that don't know, they can go to the I'll just use an example, the Signature Health on Liberty Street, that you can go there, they have urgent care, rather than going to the emergency room, because the emergency room costs are so great. Also, some of our hospitals and our medical industries have changed, because we still have some non-profit compared to for-profit. But some of the companies out there, and I won't mention names, have closed, and some of the Quincy hospitals that, we used to have three hospitals in Brockton, including the Veterans Administration Hospital. We had, Goddard Hospital, it's in Stoughton, but it's right over the Brockton line. We had the Brockton Hospital, and then we had the Cardinal Cushing. Cardinal Cushing changed. There's a new corporation that runs that now. They're trying to cut back on costs, and they're trying to make a profit. And this is a capitalist society. There's nothing wrong with making a profit, but you don't want to do it at the expense of the public and the people you're trying to serve. And that, I think, has happened in the industry. And there's a lot of pressure because, from the administration side, they're trying to keep costs down, so they're putting pressure on their employees. And then, as you mentioned, you got to visit so many patients at one time because they're trying to get, reimbursed from the Medicaid and Medicare and everything else out there. And that's caused a major problem with our society. We do have another event to attend to at 10 o'clock today at City Hall. And I apologize, but anything we can be of help as state legislators, please don't hesitate to contact us, whether it be working to pass legislation. Funding is always a difficult thing. We're always trying to get more funding for our communities in Brockton outside the district. It's always tough, but we also have a great relationship working with our speaker, and I know it was mentioned earlier, so he's formed a commission to look into what we're talking about today. And our chairman of public health, Jeff Sanchez, has a very open door policy, so he's willing to listen to ideas. And then we have another committee on healthcare finance, and we're all trying to work together. So if we have to leave before this is over, we apologize, but please don't hesitate to contact our office, because I don't have all the answers. And without all of the people in this room, I did serve in the community of management at the Y several years ago, was before my career changed. Preventive medicine is key, and I was hoping somebody from the school system was here as well, because at a young age, and hopefully they're teaching these young people, like some of us as we get older, we get thick in our, stuck in our ways and thick-headed sometimes, and it's tough to change our ways. I do have some good news, shocking as it may seem. My cholesterol numbers were the best they ever were this past week. I've had high cholesterol and high blood pressure for years, but all it was changing my diet. Now, if I stick to my diet plan, it may help, but I've got to get back to the gym as well. I used to work out at the Y, and I recently won 3 different memberships to 3 different Ys, so someone's trying to give me a little boot to get back in action. But when I was younger and I had more time, I was very active, but you get set running around like a chick with his head cut off, and even today we've got like 20 places to be all at once. It's tough, and we've got to do a better job with time management. But please don't hesitate to contact our offices with any ideas you have, because you are the experts in the field, and without your input and the ideas you have, we can't do our job more effectively. So thank you, and I apologize if we got to cut out a little while, but again, please don't hesitate to contact us.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for coming.
So hard act to follow, but I just want to say I'm Alan Johnson from Hope Health, and in addition to our hospice and dementia and Alzheimer's services, I wanted to just put out there that Hope Health provides primary care in people's homes. And this is a rather innovative, actually old-time kind of medical care, because we've brought back the days of seeing people. The doctor arrives at the home with the black bag and does the whole medical exam in the home, like our grandparents used to have. And we've brought back that kind of health care. So anywhere in southeastern Massachusetts, if the person has an obstacle to getting into their home, I'm sorry, into the primary care doctor, we can provide primary care in their home, which is wonderful for southeastern Massachusetts and is a rather innovative program. So I thought I'd mention that. Hello, camera.
So, as I mentioned just a moment ago, many of you have already brought up the idea of a community health worker. What is the range of and type of providers, traditional and non-traditional, that our local system uses to support patients?
As people warmed up a little bit during question one, what I really like to encourage now is some group discussion at the table. So let's all discuss as a group, because this is what we do best in Southeast, so let's show Jessica how it's done in the Southeast region. So let's have a little bit of a demo discussion and then choose one person. It could be the group facilitator, the report back. Is that okay? So let's have a couple of minutes of group discussion, and I'll have Hillary repeat the question again. Thank you.
What is the range of and type of providers, traditional and non-traditional, that our local system uses to support patients?
I think you're the closest to someone in actually.
I didn't really hear what the topic was. I mean, a question.
She works for IBM Test Solutions. She's a practitioner.
Oh, well, we use you too.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, so we piggyback with them so that our clients don't have to leave.
Right.
And they can just stay.
And that's what I was trying to bring up.
In the second, I want to just ask that everybody to go around and share a few comments from each table. But we want to make sure that we capture everything that's being said. So I noticed a lot of people taking notes. Any notes that you want to share with us at the end, please do. That's exactly why we have our little sticky notes on the table. So if we go around and we don't have enough time to capture all of your comments, we still want them and we still need them. So, Where would we be like, why don't we start front and center here if somebody can appoint a spokesman? Oh, we got Lauren. Okay.
Okay, so our table talked about the fact that there is really a wide range of providers, all the way from primary care down to smoking cessation specialists who go out and work with individuals to help them quit smoking. That the communities are loaded with agencies, but who's really controlling the healthcare landscape? Is it up in the hospitals? And then we have the comment that it's really where the funding goes, where a lot of the work is being done. So if there's funding, that's where we can do the work because there's money to do that. And that's really part of the challenge. Another, we did discuss a little bit more about community health workers and that they are not reimbursable and that they're not necessarily defined. So a smoking cessation specialist could be considered a community health worker, but there's not really right now a certification for them or a definition of exactly what that means. And so we can't reimburse for them right now, which makes it hard to figure out how to pay for community health workers, which are, it was talked about that they're not used enough. We don't have enough of them, and it's tough for them to connect to patients as well. And funding, again, we said that a little bit earlier, limits what can be done with some providers. And then there, another thing that came up was homeopathic medicine or alternative medicine. We're not really sure how that fits in to this. And grassroots, so a doctor not working necessarily in the hospital or as a primary care, but more on the policy work in the boards of health and out in there in the community to try to change policy to get some work done.
Good job.
So our table talked a lot about community health workers and how important they are in connecting patients to their care. So community health workers, patients, and primary care physicians sort of all bridge together. With the community health workers, we see that both language and cultural understanding is really strengthened. We also talked a lot about family support. So when home visits happen, we really see what is happening in the home, and we are really able to help families work together, either supporting the patient and their illness and or supporting the family members. Because oftentimes when family members are sick, they're doing a lot of work. So having community health workers come in and or having doctors come and do home visits, that really helps to support not only hopefully the diseased patient, but also the family members. We also talked about the importance of chronic disease self-management groups and how educating patients that they are really integral parts of their care and really motivating them to be prepared when they go to doctor's visits. God knows 15 minutes is never enough. And so when community health workers are able to train patients with the chronic disease models, patients arrive, they have their medications with them, they have questions ready to ask the doctors, and they feel that they are, you know, they are a part of their care. We talked about how important nurses and physical therapists, diabetes educators and nurses are, and so that we all can sort of be reinforcing what the patient's needs are and what disease management looks like.
A lot of the providers have like a lot of programs on education and classes and a lot of opportunities for people to be educated and become more informed on health and health issues and things that can really help them. But one of the big problems is the communication. We were talking about, you know, a lot of places have like flyers and brochures and bulletin boards with things on them, and those are the same ones that a lot of patients walk past when they're in the doctor's office and leave and don't pick it up, or someone else said they'll be in the doctor's office for 2 hours and won't even pick one of those up. So it's just about, you know, finding the right route to get to the patient, to bridge the gap, which is like to bridge the gap between between the providers and the community, and letting them know that those things are available, those classes and the education is there. We just have to find a way to get to the patient and bring it to their attention so they're more informed.
We started talking a bit about how there's a variety of terms for ACOs. It can be a little bit confusing for patients to navigate that system. So it's, you know, it's important to explain it to them, explain how their healthcare is going to run, and just sort of so they can understand that whole process. With community health workers, a bit like Lauren's table, we talked a lot about how there is a range of community health workers. And so it really depends on their expertise. We have a few representatives from Old Colony Elder Services. So we talked a little bit about the elder population and how
their expertises can really branch off. So some of the community health workers will focus on socialization. Others may focus on like grandparents raising children, for example. So there's just a wide variety of expertise for community health workers. We also talked about certifications for community health workers, which is not in place yet, but it's legislated. And there is a board of certification for that process. So that's something else that we talked a bit about.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Michelle Dubois. I'm a state representative and city councilor. So at my table, we have three state representatives and two people that work in the healthcare industry, as well as a patient who is now learning to be an advocate for other patients. So my table is kind of a learning table, and some of the things we talked about is that they're community health workers at the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center, and our desire to really understand how to communicate to patients effectively that are maybe going through cancer, or stage four cancer, understanding what kind of treatment options there are. So we're, you know, kind of more of a learning table, some of us at this table. And just personally, my background, I'm interested in having more outreach workers, like on vans, doing mammograms, ovarian screenings, more healthcare workers in the community for homeless individuals. And that's just some things that I would like to see happen in Brockton. Thank you.
Thank you.
We talked about quite a lot of things. So the question actually started out with asking about the range and types of providers that we use. And here at this table, we have a couple of VNAs. So, you know, usually when you think about a visiting nurse association, you really just think about nurses. But there's a lot more than just nurses. So we have therapists as well, physical therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapists as well, obviously the nurses, and we have behavioral health nurses. We also work with nurse practitioners, so that we're able to send a nurse practitioner out after hours to see a particular patient to try to keep that patient out of using the emergency room. But we also discussed a lot of problems that we're seeing as well. And a lot of that is that we find that our patients are not really given options of all of the different organizations and things that they have at their disposal. Many times when you go into a hospital, you are given sort of one choice. Like, for example, a visiting nurse association. You may not know that you have choices of various ones that you can choose, and oftentimes those things are chosen for you, and that's not right. Another thing that somebody here at the table brought up, and it's very true, is when you call into your healthcare provider, the first thing that you hear, you don't hear a human answering the phone, you hear a recording, and what does that recording say? The very first thing it says is if this is a medical emergency, please hang up and call 911. Well, you know, what is a medical emergency to a lot of people, you know? So I think that many times people are calling that 911 number and using those emergency services. You know, we saw the 44% of people that are actually doing that. Somebody else brought up that we have healthcare organizations ordering batteries of tests, labs, and studies simply because it is what the insurance company is requiring. You know, so I know for my dad, for example, who's 90 years old, why does he need a colonoscopy at this point? You know, because what are we gonna do if there is something there? You know, so really those things don't need to be paid for. You really have to kind of think about those things before you just blindly agree to have certain things done or not done. Somebody else brought up the fact about when they go in to see their PCP, oftentimes the PCP walks into the room staring at a computer screen and saying, oh, so, you know, I see your blood pressure was this, and when's the last time you had your mammogram? And they're really not making any eye contact with you, and then saying, okay, we'll see you back in 6 months. Everything looks wonderful. And the thing that I wanted to bring up as well, so myself and Diane are certified diabetes educators. I just went to a conference last week put on by the American Diabetes Association. And one of the things that they said, it's just mind-boggling. I knew it, but to hear it over and over again, that literally it's only about 6.5% of people that are newly diagnosed with type 2 diabetes that ever get any sort of formal diabetes education in their first 12 months of diagnosis. And I can't tell you how many people we met this last week with Brockton Knocks Down Diabetes that we're bringing up the fact that they've received more education, you know, here in the community during that past week than they've ever received in all of their career of having diabetes. We really need to do a better job of having our providers provide the information to our patients so that they know what's out there and what's available to them. So we talked about a whole bunch of stuff.
Thank you so much, and thanks everybody for sharing. I'll kind of just sum up what we've heard about for Hillary's section. So I think what we just heard about in the table discussions, I feel like a lot of tables brought up with how we're communicating with patients and how we're connecting them to those services, and that it's not quite where it should be, which is really what we're thinking about when we talk about patient-centered medical home, is that we're thinking about the patient, communicating to the patient, and not with brochures and pamphlets that they're going to walk by on the wall. We also talked about that right now we're really more traditional and that a lot of patients are using the ER for chronic disease conditions, and they maybe don't know about urgent care opportunities. And even the people in this room, we don't know the whole range of providers that we have and what is a community health worker. So with that, I'm going to move on to the next. We'll start with a raffle. We'll kind of take a deep breath from those questions. So I want you to think about this question from a community perspective. So if you think about the clients that you work with or just in your own personal life as well, what is the biggest barrier to consistent, effective health care? And you can choose one of those options. So it looks like the highest, according to everybody in this room, is copay and high cost. And second would be transportation. Followed by lack of adequate health
insurance.
Sorry. Uninsured, underinsured. Does anyone have a reaction to this?
I think it should be all of you.
Great, thank you. So definitely, these are all certainly barriers, and it's really, we don't have the answer of which one is the highest, and possibly they're all equal, depending on the person. So I will actually now move on to the next question, and I'll pass it on to Alexandra. The next questions will be more of that open forum that we started with, so please feel free to open up, share. We're all learning here, so definitely share your thoughts with the whole group, and let's have a discussion about patient management.
Good morning. So the next question is, what partnerships, both formal and informal, or languages currently exist between healthcare and community-based organizations to support our patients?
I mean, definitely, I would have to say the Y and Rockland Neighborhood Health Center. We definitely collaborate together to bring some of your patients down, or workouts or memberships, and then also providing classes for your individuals as well.
So if anybody didn't hear that, the Y and Community Health Center working together, providing fitness classes and
So the Brockton Visiting Nurse Association has sort of an informal relationship with the Brockton Council on Aging, where we go in routinely and provide chronic disease self-management classes. And we also have a more formal relationship with Brockton Neighborhood Health Center as well, where we go in and provide diabetes self-management education to Brockton Neighborhood Healthcare clients there at the Neighborhood Health Center.
I would say this is kind of an innovative thing in general, but housing authorities are becoming more more connected with their patient, or not their patients, their residents, and are slowly getting involved in their health as well.
Okay. We also have agreements with the CSAs to provide food for people. So from the hospitals, the community health workers will bring patients food.
Into the hospital?
From the hospital. Like the okay. hospital purchases the CSA for the people.
Okay.
And I just wanted to say that I think one of the things that I have seen are the relationship between community health centers and churches. Because many churches now are looking at health as a part of their community, because many of the folk that go to the health center or to the hospital are their congregants. And so that linkage between community health centers, the healthcare facilities, and the churches is vitally important, and is really a good program.
And can I just ask a question? When you say bringing things into housing, do you have any specific
Examples, yes.
So
in particular, and I know something that's going on in Quincy and Weymouth right now, I know that this is Brockton focused, but there actually are some things that are going on in Brockton as well that we've talked about, but there are things like Tai Chi classes or the just things that get people more active, implementing, I do smoking cessation, so those are going into housing authorities becoming completely smoke-free. It's basically just focusing on chronic disease management in general.
So in, here in Brockton, as Shauna said, the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center and YMCA have a partnership, and we also have a partnership with Brockton Housing. So we, for the next 6 months, will be going from different Brockton housing sites, and we are bringing yoga and also smoking cessation. So when we say clinic to community, we mean, you know, that's clinic to community in action.
The Visiting Nurse Association goes into the housing across Brockton, and also the Council on Aging. We do blood pressure, blood sugar screenings as well. And we also do, we've done chronic disease self-management, some of the housing projects as well.
Thank you.
Any apartment complex that receives funding from HUD should have a residential services coordinator in place. And the residential services coordinator is responsible for educating the residents in her housing complex. You can approach the resident services coordinator about any type of an educational class you wish to put on, whether it be about diabetes, heart health, smoking cessation, and they will probably be more than happy to have you put on a seminar at their site. They also do health fairs, so you can request that you're invited to any health fair they have also.
Thank you.
Food pantries and soup kitchens are beginning to be, healthcare agencies begin to see them as a place to deliver education, surveys, et cetera. Whether it's a local health center coming, or whether it's a program that's being promoted, or in the health van coming, making the rounds to the various places. That's a linkage I'm beginning to see happen more and more.
I just wanted to piggyback first on the comment you just made about the housing facilities. Here in Brockton, Beacon Properties has been doing a good job of that. They've reached out to Signature quite a few times to go in and participate in health fairs for their residents, provide smoking cessation classes or whatnot. So I think that's a great thing. Also, we have, I guess, an informal relationship with the Old Colony Y, although we work with them so often. I feel like I see them every day. But, you know, they have come in and their health coaches have gone into our Bridgewater office to provide the Y diabetes prevention program for our patients. And so that's a great thing as well. And then Signature has gone to some of the Y branches to provide nutritional guidance for some of their members through the Smallest Winner program and otherwise. So that's been a great relationship.
So at Old Colony Elder Services, we're actually working, we provide Meals on Wheels for at-home bound seniors, but we also have congregate meal sites, and some of them are in the housing sites. There's one like at Manning and Campello. So we are providing healthy meals, and we do provide seven different therapeutic meals as well.
I'll just add to that. We actually serve over about 23 towns, and we get good referrals from the community, Neighborhood Health Center, Signature Health. You guys are like great referral sources, so we do that. And besides the meals, we provide home care services, and it could be, you know, companionship, someone home health aid, homemaking. We do provide a lot of services for elders to stay at home and disabilities. So we do serve over 23 towns, and again, you guys are the great referral sources, and we have the workshops, the healthy living, diabetes workshop, chronic disease self-management, Tai Chi, pain. So we have a lot that we are providing out there. Thank you.
Organization work, we partnership with Walgreen to provide CPR training to the churches, to the members of our congregation, and also during the flu shot. The flu season, we work with Walgreens as well to go to the churches and provide a flu shot for their helpers as well.
My name is Brian Vicente. I'm a store director at Vicente Supermarket, and we do a lot of work in the community, and we constantly support Brock the neighborhood and support the Y on any events or any causes that they have going. And we definitely look to build on that relationship with the new supermarket opening very soon. So that's definitely something we want to build on. And when that opens up, we want to use that as a tool and as a key to help out a lot more in the community and anything else that they're doing, we'd love to support.
Cindy's Market are starting, I think, a pretty innovative supermarket and community health center site. So at the end of this month, Vicente's supermarket will be opening, and then in the beginning of September, the Neighborhood Health Center's second site will be opening. So when we say innovative and clinic to community, I think if you all come to the corner of Warren and Pleasant, you will see that in action.
Thank you. I just want to mention we have another event, Representative Cronin, myself at City Hall, previously scheduled, unfortunately. But thank you again for everybody coming today. And please don't hesitate to do a follow-up after this meeting, because we have to continue this. One last thing that I wanted to mention, we did pass some legislation for proper staffing levels in emergency rooms and also urgent care departments within the hospitals. So it went before the Public Health Commission last week to discuss how the law is going to be implemented, and there was discussion on is urgent care considered just the intensive care unit, or does it include pediatric urgent care or infant urgent care? So there was a lot of debate. So some of the commission's decisions, it's not going to be all implemented overnight. It's going to take some time within the next 18 months or longer. We were hoping as legislators and the leadership that everything was included with that urgent care situation, but anything we can be of help with, please don't hesitate to contact us. And I apologize, our schedules conflict today. One last thing too, there was a thing at the Council on Aging today. It's about elder abuse, and it was supposed to be a march against elder abuse, but with the weather, they may just have it indoors, I'm not sure, but it's early this afternoon, so anybody who wants to come to that to give your input to and help out, you're more than welcome.
I'd like to once again recognize and thank State Representative Michael Brady. Thank you for coming. We understand that everyone's on a tight schedule. Representative Michelle Bois, thank you so much for coming, and I know you will be leaving early. And Representative Claire Cronin just left the room. So again, I thank all three for taking the time to really listen to what we have to say.
Thank you again.
As I've been listening to everybody talk, they've talked about diabetes, they've talked about smoking cessation, they're talking about food and different things that supplying food to people, and also different physical activity they get people into. One thing I haven't heard anything about is dental. I don't know whether it's a big phobia with people, but the thing is, your mouth is the gateway to the rest of the body, and prevention is a very big part. 90% of the population has some stage of gingivitis. Kids, I found that even with fluoride, we thought dentists, when fluoride first came out, they thought, oh, we're going to be out of business. Nobody's going to have any cavities to fill. Unfortunately, because of the economy, parents are feeding their kids high sugar things, things that are easy for them to quickly give the kids. And unfortunately, I find so many kids drinking soda three times a day for meals and not milk or water or something else. The decay rate I've seen in Brockton, I worked in a practice in Brockton, we would have little kids come in with totally bombed out teeth. All the teeth had to be extracted. They were too far gone to even try to crown. We've had little kids call the office after we've gone out and talked to some of the schools, and they called and said they were in pain. An adult said, you hang up that phone. So we have no idea what happened to that little girl that called, or whether she ever got help. We've seen kids come in with abscesses. And people don't realize that an abscess can be deadly. Some of the things in the mouth can be deadly. Kids have died from this. And it's also with the elderly. It's a big problem because their immune system is compromise, thank you. Can't find those words. So I just want to try to open people's minds to try to think a little bit more of trying to include dental into some of these things you offer people. And if you want information, I'd be more than happy to give it to you.
Thank you.
So really providing more services. I'll go over here.
So I totally agree with you. So dentition is something that we absolutely teach about in diabetes self-management education as well. But I think that we need to do a much better job at financially helping people to pay for their dental care. That is the biggest obstacle that I run across. Is when I that's the first one of the first questions that we ask a person when we first meet them. When they come to diabetes self-management, when we do our assessment, is when's the last time you saw a dentist? So many people don't go, because even the few that do have dental insurance, the coverage is abysmal. It's absolutely horrible. I know for my own son, who's 19, he needs 2 root canals and 2 caps, and it's crazy money. It's like well over $5,000. So that's what's prohibiting people, is the cost and the lack of coverage. And even when we do have dental insurance, it's just absolutely abysmal, the cost that we need to come up with on our own. So we need to do a better job of that if we expect people to get into dentists more often.
So I will come over here. I just want to bring it back to the question. We want to focus right now on what linkages we do have, and then a little bit later in the discussion we'll talk about what might be missing.
For mental health, and can I start maybe the conversation about the need that exists? And I really can't think of too many chronic, as well, its own chronic illness, especially when it comes to dementia or related to Alzheimer's or other forms of dementia. So that was going to be my comment, just that, wow, where's the mental health in all of our general health care? And I know it's supposed to be a part of overall health, but something lacking. And we could use a little help in using more, maybe it's more social workers we need at VNA or something.
Thank you.
Another question is, for healthcare providers, what is working well and what could be improved? And I think, Alan, you just, touching on mental health. I think mental health is such a huge issue for our residents, especially here in Brockton. So when we're talking about diabetes and depression are really hand in hand. And so if we're not screening for depression when we're screening for diabetes, are we missing a really big piece? And when we're making referrals and patients aren't showing up, are we ever thinking about why patients aren't getting out of their home? Just because, your doctor says you need to go to and the patient says yes, that doesn't always come to fruition. So I think it's really important that when you, are providing your care, and one of the checkboxes is to screen for depression, I think it's really important that just as we're screening for other really important things, we're making sure that all those boxes have the right checks.
I interned as a marketing assistant at the Children's Advocacy Center in Bristol County, which we also have an advocacy center at BAMSI in Brockton, so it's very much valid here too. And what Children's Advocacy Center is a center for children who are victims of sexual abuse, severe violence, or witness to extreme violence. So what we strive to be is a multidisciplinary place where you can come in and it can be a one-stop shop for the child in order to try to prevent further trauma that will cause mental health care to skyrocket for them in their future. And we also house a PDCA nurse, which is a nurse who specializes in children's sexual anatomy. So if the child needs a rape kit, they can have it on site. They don't have to travel to the emergency room and sit and very much be further traumatized with that experience. We also have a forensic investigator who specializes in speaking to children. So they don't have to be interviewed in the adult model, which is kind of harsh for young children. I'm speaking children's mostly age 0 to 12. So something that I feel like we could really benefit from is having a psychiatrist on facility. We have a mental health coordinator, but the fact is we are a 501c3. We cost no money to the patients that come in and the families that are very much multilingual. We have a large language barrier, which we provide interpreters for and whatnot. But if there was a way to house a psychiatrist without having the astronomical costs of having one in facility, I just feel like that could be really beneficial. And even though we do have a mental health coordinator who sits down with the family and the children, just sending them out of the facility when they can come back to us. We do have caseworkers and social workers, we're not on site, that speak with the children and they follow the case, they review it. But if there was a way for that to happen and keep the cost down for the families too, who can't afford to be, you know, even paying these co-pays are really high for them. So I just feel like that would be great.
What's working well versus what perhaps
what can be improved?
Yes. So I'm going to go back to community health workers and all those titles that fall under that great big umbrella. I think that we have already seen tremendous success if community health workers are picked carefully, trained properly, and integrated carefully into their teams. I think we can see tremendous, and we have seen tremendous success. So then that leads me to think about dental and mental. Could community health workers work in those areas that are seriously underserved if those same things are applied, the picked carefully, trained properly, and integrated into the team?
I do, thank you. I think our collaborations have come a long way over the past few years, so I think that's one area that we're really, really gaining some momentum in. I think we just need to continue that, and then going forward, probably for me, with the needs of the members that we're serving. You know, I can go out and go anywhere in the city, but obviously I don't speak the language, so having the interpreters available and building our staff with individuals that look like people in our community and that are the people in our community is going to be the biggest challenge, I think, going forward.
I know for myself, I think that the biggest challenge comes with drugs and alcohol. I do a lot of referrals for drugs and alcohol, but when you have a person who is actively using, it's very, very difficult to get them services and treatment. I'll call one person in my Rolodex and they will say, oh no, you know, we're for aftercare, we're for outpatient, call this number. So I call that number and they say, oh no, they have to go through such and such a program first. So they refer me to the program. I call the program and they say, oh no, they haven't been screened yet. So they refer me to the place that does the screening. The place that does the screening says to me, oh well no, they have to be sober for a certain amount of time. I say, well, how do I get them sober without all of your services? And they say, well, the only real place for a person to actually sober up if they're actively using is in a medical facility. I can't get them into a medical facility just because they're drinking. So I'm back to zero again. And it just seems absolutely impossible to get a person who is actively using and is screaming for help into any type of a treatment. And I face this dilemma all the time.
And then oftentimes those treatments are 5-day or 30-day programs. And you know, it's a chronic disease. People who are actively using alcohol or drugs, that's a chronic disease as well. And a 5-day or a 30-day is not going to do it. And oftentimes that's really their only options when they get there.
What's not working or what we need to improve is the waiting list. The waiting list for the mental health part. So when you make a referral, when you're waiting for a child to be served, and you hear that 3 months or 2 months, that's too long for services. We need to do something about the waiting list.
Is there anything else that anybody wanted to add on that question?
I just comment is the role, I'm loud, I don't think I'm gonna but the role of prevention in all of this. We've talked a lot about managing the illness once it happens, but a lot of these things are preventable. And you know what occurs to me, especially in the realm of the community health, is the role that a community health worker can have in prevention, as opposed, you know, to finding services once the disease has already occurred.
And the last question is for CBOs, so community-based organizations.
That was a nice segue, wasn't it?
What's working well and what could be improved. So what other things do we think are working well with our community-based organizations?
As part of the Brockton Knocks Down Diabetes, one of the things that I think has resonated statewide, because you know I'm hearing from other entities that are very much interested in what has been done here. And that is to be able to bring not only community nonprofits to the table, but for-profits, health centers, Harbor One, and all of these entities that come together and are really looking at the ultimate goal, which is to knock down diabetes. That to me is key to how we can be more effective as a community, because here you have the perfect example of community coming together and being able to put our self-interest aside, because we're all looking for funding, and be able to do this. And I'm saying, how do we leverage that? And as a community, come together and say, you know what? You know, we can do this. Come what may, we can do this. And this is, you know, this has been going on, and each year it gets better and better, and more partners are coming on board. And I think that works. That works well. But, you know, I do want to emphasize putting our self-interest aside and really looking at the community.
I think it's really important to, when we're thinking about all the different ages, and so as the director of the senior center, there's people who are 60 and there's people who are 90, and they look very different. So trying to make sure that we are really trying to listen to the needs and of the people that are that we're trying to serve, because the issues that are issues for one may not be the issues for the other. But I also think that really getting people's voices of that, and how do we, the best teachers, you know, one of the things we see is like in fire prevention or different things like that, the kids come home with their information from the schools that say, hey, did you know that we have to do this or that? So how do we engage the families a little bit differently to help their loved ones get the services that they need as well and good education?
Another resource that's working well that hasn't been mentioned yet is that for the veterans, and I don't know if you've heard of the Dog Tag Navigators. Cecil Hickman really works well with them. So if you do have the veterans, they've helped them with the navigating, you know, with diabetes and all their health care, you know, their benefits for their family members. So that's a community source that really works well.
I think we're doing a better job of not telling people what they need to do, rather than having them advocate for themselves and taking control, a little bit more control of their life, and stop telling people, okay, you need to do X, Y, Z, and it's okay, we're helping them decide what they need to do better.
Great, thank you. So more lifestyle change and behavior management rather than go exercise. That is a lot to sum up, but, and again, all of these notes will be put together and shared with everybody. So we talked about, I think we did focus a little bit on barriers, but we did talk about that there are services in community-based organizations that connect patients to the healthcare centers and vice versa. So raffle time again. And okay, so now we're from a healthcare perspective. So even if you work in a community-based organization, picture it from a healthcare provider perspective. What is the biggest barrier to consistent, effective patient care? So whether that's from your own point of view, the point of view of your clients or patients, figuring out how to refer patients and working with the whole patient rather than just diabetes and forgetting about other health concerns. And then the second being lack of time with each patient, which did come up also in the discussion. Okay. And again, obviously all of these can be a barrier, but we definitely had higher ones there. So now I'm going to pass it on to Julie Lohm, who will talk about data availability and sharing. And we'll all talk about it. So again, please share your thoughts.
Morning, everybody. Before we actually talk about data availability and sharing, we did skip over one of the first questions when Hillary was up, and her topic area was healthcare landscape. So just to go back to that topic for a second,
The question is, do referral pathways exist outside of the traditional clinic system that link patients with additional supports and services provided by community-based organizations? So I know that for the Brockton VNA and Brockton Neighborhood Health Center, we are working for the e-referral grant pilot project. And so that particular referral pathway is a provider at Neighborhood Health Center recognizes that a patient of theirs could benefit from diabetes self-management education. And they use their e-referral system to refer a patient to me, to myself and Diane at Brockton Visiting Nurse Association. And electronically, I've been able to open up the portal pathway and get the patient's contact information, contact the person, and go ahead and schedule the appointment. So we've been doing this for about the last year or so. So that's one that exists for us at Neighborhood Health Center. Is there anything else for any of the other organizations?
Actually, O'Connell Health Services and their evidence-based programs are working with the Healthy Center of Excellence. And we're getting referrals from the Tufts program.
For our YMCA's diabetes prevention program, it's in the paper form at this point. And then also for our Live Strong Cancer Exercise program, Enhanced Fitness, all of our prevention and management programs.
One thing that we've been working really hard with is to, when you talk about non-traditional ways, is that the fire department, when they take people on an ambulance call, are calling the Council on Aging so that we can follow up with them on to make sure that they have the additional services that they need, not just so somebody fell and they picked them up or they transported them, but then what can we do to make sure that they're not going back into the hospital or to get the supports we need to stay at home?
Anything else to add?
I think a lot of times that the people who are on the front line see the person who needs the referral, and they might not necessarily know where to go. And I'm just looking at this from a housing perspective. And if you want to get the word out about your agency and let people know that you are accepting referrals or would like referrals, a good place to go would be MARSH, and that stands for the Massachusetts Resident Services Coordinators in Housing, and the president works at Boston Housing for the TAP program, which is the Tenant Assistance Program. They do a lot of outreach for training and education with people in low-income housing. Her name is Sylvette Betancourt, and she can refer you to the chapter president for whatever region of Massachusetts you're in, whether it's Bristol County or Plymouth County, and they will be more than happy to put the word out to their resident services coordinators.
Thank you. Okay. All right, so now we will segue into the next topic area, which is data availability and sharing. So the question is, what is the status of electronic medical records, EMRs, or electronic health records, EHRs, system adoption? So in other words, what are the names of the different EMRs being used out there? And we'll delve further after that. So I'll just quickly say, for us, it is BVNA uses Allscripts. And I will say that there's another healthcare organization here in this room that we work very closely with, who also uses Allscripts. However, they're two separate entities altogether. They absolutely do not communicate. And that's a very big frustration for us, is the lack of integration and communication between one EMR system and another.
Hi, I'm Nate House. I'm a member of Children, Families, and the Disabled, and we're talking about legislation that would create what they call an electronic backpack with children that are in foster care that is more or less tracking of all their medical interactions, all these different types of like shots, and again, I'm not a medical expert in any way, but I would like to maybe talk with people in this room about what you think about this electronic backpack that would follow children in foster care and adoptive settings so that they can make sure that they get the medical services that they need because they move so much. I don't know if that's in line with this, but
absolutely.
I'm really interested in that and getting professionals' opinion on if it's something we should look into and support or maybe not. Thank you.
I personally think it's a great idea. We were foster parents for a child some years ago, and this particular little boy had type 1 diabetes as well. And it was very difficult to know, because he was only a young child, you know, what he had already received, what he did to his dental condition, you know, what he was due for, what he was overdue for. So I think it's really important that we delve into something like that to coordinate care for these kids.
And I do just want to point out the definitions in case you needed some guidance of EMR and EHR are on those sheets on your tables.
Good morning. To build on that, it's very important for children. I work for a nurse practitioner group that does nothing but home visits, and we use what we call practice fusion. And the families actually have access to their records because they're usually advocating for the elderly who can't always manage it. And they can interface with the different things and they don't have to worry about scripts. So it's very important as we move forward to make sure that all of the different electronic can interface. We haven't quite mastered that so that you can share that information, but you know, to build for children and for the biggest population of aging, which is baby boomers growing by 10% a year, you know, it's a population that needs assistance to be able to access things instead of having to call up.
Not only do I think that that's a fantastic idea, but I would like to see that carried over to the homeless population also. I'd like to see people who are in shelters and hotels have that electronic backpack also.
So the electronic medical record systems that we do have, do any of them include clinical decision support? So in other words, do any of them have sort of a flag that will alert the provider that this particular patient, based on the data that has been entered into their record, really should be followed up for this or followed up for that? So any red flags or things like that that show up in your electronic medical records? Like what?
Drug interactions, whether or not some of the testing has been completed for lab work, follow up on that, but mostly drug interactions, and they're very good at doing regular updates. Audrey, does it have the lab work to support why you're prescribing that medication?
So that's two of one of the other things that we have flagged for are flu vaccines and then all the vaccines as well, among others. Anyone else?
I'm here as a patient, and I have learned how to navigate through the system and advocate for myself and others. The biggest problem I'm seeing, and I've researched this, and I've tried to go a little bit further with this as far as my legislators and my representatives, electronic medical records have a very high rate of inaccuracy.
Yeah.
I've spoken to my doctors. They all have difficulty navigating through the system, and it's very difficult. I have people who I've spoken to who are women with men's problems noted in their electronic medical records. I have a physician who refuses to use the program, and he pays the fine. He said, "This is how I run my office. There are the folders." It is very, very difficult. I myself have probably 20 addendums in my own medical record because I read my record. People don't understand that you can go and you can get your medical record and review it. It's so important. And my biggest thing was if I went to the emergency room and I was unconscious and my medical records were wrong, what's going to happen to me? I could die. I could die. And that is my biggest complaint as a patient. And that's why I'm learning to advocate for others as well as myself and to empower people to look out for themselves and advocate for themselves and make sure that their records and everything about their history is accurate. And that's one of the biggest frustrations that I see.
But I realize, so I work a lot with dementia patients who have Alzheimer's and very often wander. I've also in the past worked with homeless folks and people on various drug and alcohol problems. And I realize this population of people who need healthcare, and they're sort of hard to find and hard to track. And I do a better job caring for my dog, who has an electronic chip in her, so I can find her if she goes missing. And I just thought I'd mention that as an odd little fact. It's electronic, and I'm also a provider that has to sit and write in electronic medical records, and I hate it. And every time I go anywhere to another location, the electronic medical record is completely different than the one before, and then that one doesn't change, doesn't stay the same, it changes every year. And it's kind of a nightmare to get it all, to get the work done, especially if you're in the field, out in the car, and provide that information accurately. So that's my two cents worth, thank you.
Even something just as important as, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to like jump. Medicine reconciliation, making sure that every provider is aware of exactly what medications this particular patient takes. I know, you know, as our parents age, we become healthcare provider or healthcare advocates for our parents. And as I said, my dad is 90, and he's been seen by the same healthcare organization for the last 8 years. But whenever there is a med change, you know, I go in and we register him for his appointment, and I'm handed a med list, and invariably it is not correct. Even though the last appointment that I was there, I get asked by the MA, you know, is this still accurate, is he still on this, and I'll update it, but it was never updated in the actual EMR. So when we go back, it's the wrong med list again, and people can die, right, if we're not exactly sure of it, the medicines that they're taking. And have an accurate update.
Just make one comment. I just noticed, there's a talk about the gaps today. One of the early quicker questions we all answered as a major area of concern is the lack of coordinated care. And here we have these electronic medical records that are really seeking to do just that. And, you know, so there's a gap between those two things, but we're hearing, I mean, at least I think I'm hearing a lot of problems with the records themselves. You know, so that's just kind of a comment that there's a big disconnect there.
So one of the questions I think you kind of touched on, but to what extent is that information shared within and between systems? I started off by saying we use Allscripts, and another healthcare facility in Brockton uses Allscripts, and they don't talk. So to what extent are your EMRs being shared or not shared with other facilities? Allison?
The health center is linked with both of the hospitals in terms, Brockton Neighborhood Health Center is linked with both of the hospitals in terms of their ER and inpatients. And so we have found that to be a huge improvement so that the doctors know what's going on, and so that when the patient comes after a hospitalization or after a trip to the ER, the doctor's prepared to meet with the patient. So that has definitely been a huge improvement. Most definitely everything that's being talked about the EMRs, they are most definitely a challenge from a clinician standpoint, and most definitely a challenge from a patient standpoint. And so I think, like many changes, change takes time. And I think the more that we advocate for ourselves as patients, and the more that we continue to demand training, I think all of us who provide services in this room could all agree with me that training is not what we do best. And so we come, you know, in on a Monday morning, and here's the new way we're going to do things. Well, you know, I don't learn things that quickly. So I think, again, advocating for patients and advocating for ourselves is most important.
I'm Paulo Gomes from Good Samaritan Medical Center, part of the Steward Healthcare System. I think it's been hugely beneficial to have that capacity with the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center within our system. I just learned over the weekend that we have 5 different ECW programs along with Meditech and Athena. One of the things that we've come to realize is that even though you might have multiple offices using ECW, depending on what version you have, they won't speak to each other. So one thing that we did discuss over the weekend is whether or not we could all move into a cloud-based system. Because so even if you have a similar system and it's a server-based, we could be in the same office and not be able to look at each other's records. So moving into a cloud-based system, I think, is one of the ways that we're looking to address that issue.
Anyone else? And the last question, how does support delivered to patients by those non-traditional providers get captured or reflected? So we may do a good job of capturing, you know, PCP visits and visiting nurse visits and things like that, but what about our non-traditional healthcare providers? How are we capturing that?
I know that in my sense, I have to report everything to my grant, the grant that I'm funded by, so I don't know if that goes back to clinical or not, because I don't really have a clinical linkage, so I think that there's a kind of gap there that needs to be addressed, I don't know.
I know with the evidence-based programs that we are providing, the surveys are sent back to the Healthy Living Center of Excellence and then shared with the DPH and the CDC.
Blood pressure screenings, writing them down for patients and telling you need to bring this to your doctor's appointment so they know what's been going on in between appointments.
And I see that as a problem because a lot of times, I know with my elderly father, I will take him to his urologist and he'll ask for a certain blood screening, and you know he'll say the next time you go to the doctors, ask for this. My father's not going to remember that. It doesn't transfer, and so he's probably been going to the urologist for a year now, and the urologist has been asking for the same blood test for a year. I think with this electronic system, hopefully, eventually there will be a way where doctors can request that information from each other, that it'll make it easier for doctors to communicate, because it just seems to me that there's a lack of communication between specialists, that a lot of times we leave that responsibility, that burden to an elderly patient or someone who is sick who is just going to forget, doesn't understand why it's important, is going to lose the slip of paper.
I have one son who's 20 and does have type 1 diabetes. So he's followed through a pediatric endocrinologist in Boston, and he also has a PCP where we live. And we just got in the mail last week from the PCP's office a request for labs, one of which saying, you know, you're way overdue for your yearly cholesterol screenings. And he's seen every 3 months at Joslin, and all of that stuff is done there. And supposedly it's all being faxed over to the PCP's office, but obviously not. So, you know, that huge lack of communication seems to be one of the same things over and over.
Again, something that we're trying to figure out, but with electronic medical record, when patients go to specialists and the specialists aren't on our same model and or we're not interlinked, that information is then being sent to us either by fax or by mail. Right. It then has to be scanned into the medical record. And, you know, number one, from a staffing perspective, that's not something that's done as quickly as we would like. And, you know, human error exists. So sometimes that information, you know, is going someplace else. So I think that it is so important that, you know, we all are working together to make sure that patient's care truly is coordinated and interconnected.
I just wanted to speak on another issue, and one of them is young adults who are transitioning from pediatric to a primary care doctor.
they have to wait an awful long time to get a primary care doctor. And I have a son who almost died in 45 days. He lost 50 pounds. He was in the emergency room 15 times in that 45 days. And his medical records were not transferred to a doctor because he didn't have a doctor. And it just happens he's perfectly fine now, but 45 days my son had no primary care doctor. And so where did those records go? They just sat in a system and they weren't given to anybody to act on. And it wasn't until my daughter went back to our pediatrician and she said, my brother's gonna die, I need your help. And he was the one that called Boston, got him right into Boston, but he wasn't his doctor either.
I think for us, one of the things that's been very helpful is being a part of an accountable care organization. So the protocols put in place to coordinate care has really been helpful, and it's helped our providers sort of understand why it's so important to coordinate that care and being able to capture as much information as possible on patients, even if the services are being provided by non-traditional providers. One of the things that we have to do is make sure that we're capturing information, measures on patient health and outcomes as part of an accountable care organization. So that's why we Stuart is sort of known for pushing that model of care, because it's a model that really supports coordinated care. We really see it as a way into the future for healthcare. So.
And then I'll just kind of answer from my perspective. You kind of talked about the question really, how do we capture non-traditional? And so at the Y, we do have the YMCA's Diabetes Prevention Program, which I've mentioned, and I'm not quite sure. I know that we do send reports back 3 times a year. So, and I think I've heard from others that we're not quite sure if it ends up in the record.
Right,
so
it really gets it, yeah.
Okay, so now I will, we're gonna ask one more quicker question so you can bring up one. This should be the easiest question you answer today. What sector are you representing today? And then the rest of the majority can be healthcare. So I now will pass on to Karen Hall, and she'll talk about future opportunities and resources.
All right, you guys have been hanging in there great for all of these really tough questions. One of the questions that I have is, what are some additional ways in which we could leverage or deepen our clinic to community linkages? So I think that we talked a lot about, you know, some where we have some gaps, but also where we have things that are really working. So, you know, we want to replicate those things and try to reduce the gap. So how do we do that? So how anybody thinks that they have someplace that's working really well, or things that think that could be replicated, or how do we start some of this work that is so vast and so broad, from everything from doctor's offices to dental to mental health to transportation and everything in between?
So additional ways that we can leverage our linkages is really what we've been saying all along, is deepening the communication. I think Alice had said that we really don't know what each organization in this room provides. What services do we provide? You know, so maybe starting a database of some sort that we can go to and say, oh, well, you know, BB&A does this and the Y can do this. And so if my patient needs this, I can refer here. And if my patient needs that, I can refer there. So that's the biggest thing, I think, is let's figure out what everybody is able to provide and get it into a single place so that we can all use it for all of our patients.
I know when I volunteered a bit at the CAC, the Children's Access Center, we did a lot of work with homeless children also. We would work with church groups or, you know, food pantries and stuff like that, where we would reach populations that are very at risk. So they didn't have, you know, any knowledge of education with, you know, child sexual abuse awareness or with their children or how to talk about that. And in these populations, such as homeless populations or illegal immigrants, stuff like that that's kind of under the map. It's not really as out there as it should be. Going out and connecting it to other groups that they knew were already there, we're seeing success with the rates going down, hopefully.
it'll continue to do that, and I just felt like that was really beneficial. If people don't know about something, if you connect it through something that they already know, in the long run, it helps everyone.
I find that transportation is a major issue. I work in Fall River, and it's not that Fall River doesn't have all of the clinics and all of the resources. It's an absolutely wonderful community to work in that aspect, but I can't get people to where they need to go walk. But if I have an elderly person who's using a walker, that bus stop might as well be across the city. And I know that there are PT1 forms, but you only get so many a year. And if this person has multiple medical complications, I find that they pick and choose who they're going to see. They're prioritizing their medical situation.
So how do you think that we could, how do you think we could follow up? So transportation's an issue. What do you think we do about it, or how do we, when we think about how do we deepen those clinic to community linkages, where does transportation fall in that?
If we can get them to the clinics.
Any thoughts?
Even if we knew that we had, say, a van going out to certain apartment towers or low-income, elderly, whatever, or even shelter sites, if we had transportation going from certain clinics on certain days, people could request that their doctors schedule their appointments on those days, or perhaps if more money were funneled towards the PT1 form so that they didn't have to prioritize and skip some appointments. I don't know, maybe other people have ideas.
So, Al, next, over here, and I'll come back.
Well, there are two things. One is, I'm looking at two models that are already in existence. One is, in the Roxbury community, what a group of us got together, we were called Brockton Knocks Down Diabetes, I can't. But it was Roxbury Rises Against Diabetes, and one of the outcomes of that was to actually develop a booklet that had all of the resources in that booklet. The only thing about that is whomever is at the table at that time got to put their input. But it's a great resource that we can actually give to patients or people who are looking for services. The other is this, and in Maine, I've been working with an organization called the South Coast or South Portland Community Health Center. And what they've done is they've actually taken and created satellite clinics in some of these places where there are homeless or if it's a housing development, so that two or three times a week there's actually a clinic that's open right there. And so, it's innovative, I think, but these are some of the things that may be able to address some of the issues with transportation and how do you get the word out.
So in the interest of time, I'll come over here, and then if you have any additional thoughts on this specific question, if you can write it on the sticky note. We are, we don't want to keep you here too long, and we have a couple more questions.
I just urge you to invite the Department of Transportation to meetings or to your health center, to whatever organization. They're very willing to come. We had them come and talk to a group of 15 health centers and 3 CBOs, and at least they're there. And also, just to urge any representatives to remind them that transportation is public health. I mean, that's our, our separation of these things hurts the whole population.
Thank you.
So we can talk about in what way we leverage deepen our clinic to community linkages. Anything else on that before? Because we have a couple more questions that we want to ask. One is, we've all talked a little bit about healthcare as well, but what do you think the role of insurance? So Massachusetts has been, long before Obamacare and everything like that, Massachusetts passed everybody to be insured. How do you think that that's working? Where do you think we're seeing some pros of that? Where are we seeing some cons of that? And what do you think we need, some of that future stuff? So do we think it's working well in Massachusetts?
Well, as far as MassHealth, they have increased a lot of things that they cut from the budget. So that is helping in a lot of ways.
So they're...
As far as dental goes, they cut a lot of things from the dental program, but it's coming back. They now do, they cut off, if you were over 21, you could only get a tooth extracted and your teeth cleaned and x-rays, you know, x-rays are cleaned twice a year. Now they've included so that anyone over 21 can get fillings done. They can get, now they can get dentures. That has come back again. So they've come back with a lot of things that were cut, which was is a blessing.
Okay. So some good things restored that they had taken out of the budget. Okay.
Some of the low-cost insurance policies that we have now, you know, through the Affordable Health Care Act, it is wonderful that we're thinking that everybody is now going to have health insurance, but many people end up choosing the plan with the lowest cost, and so then they end up having to be hospitalized and many, many things are not covered. And I think just about, you know, again, going back to diabetes, a lot of the newer insulins, insulin pump supplies, insulin pens, all of those things are many times not covered by the lowest cost insurances. And so people oftentimes have to end up being very poorly managed because they're managing their diabetes with the things that they're able to afford, and those are not optimal. So they may have insurance, but they're very poorly insured.
What about, you know, I know one of the things that all the hospitals and the health centers do is provide opportunities for people to get health insurance if they don't have it, and use those as navigators. Is that something that has been helpful for people, like as for the law and getting insurance or different things like that? Like helping to get people to attach to healthcare?
That's been absolutely helpful for a lot of people in our community.
They're great at introducing it, helping people get on it, but then it needs to be renewed on an annual basis and there's no follow-up, so people think they're on insurance and they go in and it ties up the system. So the continuity of care is not consistent.
So having to, one of the negatives is having to reapply every single year, it becomes a huge barrier for people to get health care.
Well, the reapplication process is a lot more streamlined now because we, the hospital, actually get the renewal application for the patient, who we're able to do with that with them with the phone or what have you.
Just a quick comment. I know, you know, we find that some of our patients, they move a lot. So if something was to come into the mail that they needed to renew or re-up or whatnot, it could get missed. And so then they would go to the doctors and they may not have the insurance coverage that they thought they once had.
I think another big barrier is language. The forms come for you know, reapplying and they come in English, and the majority of the patients at Brockton Neighborhood Health Center don't speak English. So, you know, if we're gonna reach our patients and reach the community, we need to reach them where they're at.
So it sounds like with Paolo's organization, you guys are helping them to do it right there, and mailing it in English or at all might not be the way to go.
The other thing is a lot of people may make just too much to get a lot of the health care, yet it's things that they need covered but they can't afford. So there's all these people that are falling in the cracks that don't have the insurance.
So the working poor, or literally the working middle class nowadays as well.
And just to add to that, I think that a big population that everybody misses who falls into that are the young 20-somethings who are just starting off in their careers. I know my kids are in their early 20s and this affects them and a lot of their friends also. They make just enough money to afford, you know, a car payment and an apartment, and they can't afford health insurance. So I know my own son hasn't been to the doctor since he was 18 and he's 24 because he cannot afford his apartment, his car payment, his car insurance, his gas, his food, and his utilities, and afford, and he makes just too much money to be on MassHealth.
Just to quickly piggyback off of that, as a 24-year-old, and in 2 years, I won't be on my parents' insurance anymore, which terrifies me, but
at the same time, I am very thankful that I can stay on my parents' insurance until I'm 26, until I'm able to kind of be, get off the ground and make just enough money where I can pay for that health insurance. But in the meantime, it is like very terrifying.
Just a few years ago, I was 21.
Yeah.
There is a health insurance that, I don't know if it's network or neighborhood, but you can, it depends on how much you make. It's a like a scale of what you'd have to pay, and it does cover. Have they looked into that?
We could probably, hopefully find health insurance issues around that. So we do have, I just want to talk about one little last thing, and then we're going to wrap it up. And then, so any other thoughts or anything like that, please use your sticky pads. We really want to hear your ideas. We want to hear things that are working well. We want to know where the gaps are. And the last one is just about one of the things that we talked about, because not only is this about Brockton, but it's about greater Brockton and regionally, and we have local government and county and state. What do you think are some of the real challenges or the benefits around things being regional? Or different things like that. So that's kind of the last area that we wanted to talk a little bit about today is how do we do this work with multi different ways and different facets. We have very many complexities around this, but we also have it as a regional issues as well. So that what works in Brockton might not work in Stoughton, what works in Stoughton might not work in East Bridgewater, different things like that. So what do you think are some of the things, either successes or, again, challenges that we've seen?
Say CAB, or I'm just saying, I know CAB is way out there, but, you know, the transportation is not the same in all the towns.
So different accessibility,
yeah,
as far as transportation?
So adds a whole other layer to transportation as well.
I know that in my organization, we just identified priority communities and then create strategies based on each of those communities, based on the resources that each of them have. So because there are some of the more wealthy communities that don't need the same kind of prevention to all the way up to care. Sorry, I can't talk anymore. But yeah, just I guess identifying the strategies and then going forth with them.
Well, I think that for me, one of the things is like having two local hospitals and a health center is a really great regional resource for us to be able to use to be able to standardize some of the care that we're, so that we are able to kind of level the playing field a little bit.
The organizations that we partner with need to be pre-approved. They need to meet certain minimal requirements depending on what ACO they fall under. So that sometimes can be a challenge in what organizations we can partner with. So they need to be approved by the insurers to be a partner with us. So.
Thank you. So we'll do a couple more raffles and then we'll wrap it up for the day. Thank you so much for coming and sharing your thoughts. As Joy said at the beginning, we will be collecting all of this and sharing what comes from it. We do hope to use it as a roadmap to kind of have a bigger understanding of what we can do to deepen the clinic to community linkage and decrease that gap that we really discussed today. So thank you so much. If you do have any questions, definitely write them on your sticky notes, your post-its, and bring them up here, or feel free to grab one of us either right here today or by email at a later time. Thank you so much.
And I also want to just extend my thank you as you guys are collecting your stuff and really for all the partners coming, and I know there's some people from Fall River who have come as well, and all the regional partners that we have here today. So thank you so much for coming, and stay dry out there and safe travels. And I'm not sure what the roads are looking like with all this rain, but thanks so much for coming out this morning.
See ya.
Good to see you.
Have a great day.